I bet you've heard someone talking about phytates or anti-nutrients found in beans, grains, nuts and seeds, and how these reduce the body's ability to absorb essential nutrients. Those compounds can be tannins, lectins, protease inhibitors, and calcium oxalate. Are they a problem though? They most definitely can be, and the reason is their chelating properties. Now, chelation just means the binding of a metal ion to an organic molecule. So, when you eat food that contains a mineral like zinc, iron, or calcium, and you also consume phytic acid, the phytic acid will bind to or chelate to the mineral. And what's the issue with that? Our bodies lack the enzyme that breaks down phytates, so we can't properly digest and absorb the nutrients that are bound up in them. That's what the anti-nutrient label is all about. For example, one study showed that when there's phytic acid, only 13% of magnesium and 23% of zinc were absorbed, as opposed to 30% when there was no phytic acid. You shouldn't be worried though, because a 1994 review of trace elements in vegetarian diets from around the world didn't find iron or zinc deficiencies in those people eating high concentrations of foods containing phytic acid. Now, how can that be? The thing is, by the time most foods high in phytic acid get to our plate, they may no longer contain enough of them to cause problems. And a less known fact is that phytates may actually have health benefits. For example, they may reduce the risk of cancer, prevent heavy metal toxicity, act as an antioxidant, protect against kidney stones, help your body produce inositol that helps your liver process fats, and has a role in muscle function as well. In addition, they may help to lower blood triglyceride levels, blood pressure, and blood sugar. And almost no one is talking about that. But still, there are certain groups of people who would benefit from knowing where phytic acid is most present in their diet and understanding how to limit it. Those are individuals who are at high risk for nutritional deficiencies and related disorders. Conditions like osteoporosis with calcium deficiency, anemia with iron deficiency, or zinc deficiency. Then individuals who have malabsorption disorders and who are at higher risk of malnutrition. This may include people who suffer from an eating disorder or who lack access to adequate food. I'll give you tips on how to reduce phytic acid in your food. Sprouting, cooking, baking, processing, soaking, and fermenting all help to destroy it and make minerals more available. One study found that pre-soaking reduced the phytic acid concentration in quinoa by about 70%. In addition, iron solubility doubled as well. And in general, soaking beans for at least 12 hours, then rinsing and cooking them in fresh water, reduces phytic acid levels by 60%. Other research indicates that when we take white sorghum, sprout it, or utilize lactic acid fermentation, we almost completely eliminate phytic acid. So overall, sprouting reduces phytates by 37 to 81% in various types of grains and legumes, and sourdough fermentation reduces phytates by 62%. This is the reason I always recommend soaking your nuts, seeds, grains, and legumes before eating them or cooking them. It's because most of the anti-nutrients in these foods are found in the skin. Since many of them are water-soluble, they simply dissolve when foods are soaked. Food combining is another way to mitigate the effects of phytic acid. For example, garlic and onions can increase the bioavailability of iron and zinc in plant foods as they enhance mineral absorption. So, adding onion and garlic to your main meals is the way to go. Another way to boost iron absorption and inhibit the effects of phytates is including vitamin C foods to your high phytate meals. Let's take another anti-nutrient, and that's oxalates. Those are natural compounds found in vegetables, fruits, nuts, and grains. Some examples of foods that are highest in oxalates include green leafy vegetables, soy, almonds, potatoes, tea, rhubarb, and cereal grains, and beets. In plants, oxalate helps to get rid of extra calcium by binding with it. And this is why so many high oxalate foods are from plant sources. As oxalates pass through the intestines, they can also, in our bodies, bind with calcium and be excreted in the stool. And when too many oxalates continue through to the kidneys, kidney stones can form. You don't need to worry though, as a study found that there was no increased risk of stone formation with higher vegetable intake. On the contrary, greater intake of fruits than vegetables was associated with a reduced risk. However, there is one food you could be conscious about, and that's turmeric. Too much of it may increase the risk of certain kidney stones. It's because turmeric is high in soluble oxalates, which can bind to calcium and cause the most common form of kidney stone, that is insoluble calcium oxalate. And that's about 75% of all cases. So those who have a tendency to form those stones should probably eat no more than a teaspoon of turmeric daily. You can also have increased oxalate levels if you're taking antibiotics or have a history of digestive diseases. It's because the good bacteria in the gut help get rid of oxalate. And when the levels of these bacteria are low, high amounts of oxalates can be absorbed. Now, what can you do about oxalates? First, increase your calcium intake when eating foods with oxalate, as it can help lower oxalate levels in the urine. So choose high calcium foods like broccoli, watercress, kale, and okra, for example. Then, boiling green leafy vegetables can reduce calcium oxalate by 19 to 87%. This is why I would recommend boiling beet greens, older spinach, and chard in plenty of water and discarding the water before you eat them. Boiling is also a good way to lower anti-nutrients like lectins, tannins, and protease inhibitors. Now, I mentioned soy containing oxalates. However, this needs some clarification. While tofu does have moderate amounts of oxalate, it also has calcium that reduces the oxalate effects. And moreover, soy contains phytates, which inhibit the formation of calcium kidney stones. One study concluded that soy foods containing small concentrations of oxalate and moderate concentrations of phytate may be advantageous for kidney stone patients or persons with a high risk of kidney stones. More on calcium negating the effects of oxalates. There was a study that tested how the addition of calcium may reduce oxalate in spinach. They compared calcium carbonate, chloride, citrate, and sulfate, and found that calcium chloride was the most effective, while calcium carbonate was the least effective. Now, if tofu is calcium sent, it is usually coagulated with either calcium sulfate or chloride. So trying to find calcium sent tofu will pay off. Now, a quick recap. Soak your nuts, seeds, grains, and legumes before you cook them. I can attest that in case of nuts and seeds, it drastically improves the taste as well. The way I do it is that I soak a batch of nuts or seeds for at least 8 to 12 hours, change the water a couple of times if needed, and then dehydrate them. I spread them in one layer onto a baking sheet and either place them on the windowsill when there's sun, or put my oven to low heat, up to 40 degrees Celsius, and leave the door slightly open by sticking a wooden spoon in between the oven door When they are thoroughly dry, I store them in glass jars in the fridge. Sprouting gives additional benefits. You can sprout mung beans, buckwheat, and even sorghum. Then fermentation. If you are up to trying my fermented buckwheat bread, let the silk groats sprout just a tiny bit before you blend them into a batter and start the fermentation process. I think the result might be the healthiest bread in the world. However, the key here is to let them sprout just a tiny bit. If you let the sprouts grow too long, the bread will fall apart as sprouting diminishes the starch content. Other than bread, you can also ferment your pancake batter for an extra boost. Then boil high oxalate greens like beet greens, chard, and older spinach and add calcium-rich foods to that meal. Eat vitamin C-rich foods with iron-rich foods. Besides making the iron more easily absorbable, vitamin C decreases the ability of phytic acid to block iron absorption. So make sure to add lime or lemon juice, raw bell peppers or raw cabbage to your iron-rich plant meals, like meals including legumes, grains, leafy greens, and nuts and seeds. Add onions and garlic to your main meals. Let's put all that I shared into practice right away. Think about what you heard today and assess your own cooking practices. And then consider adding anything to your repertoire that seems realistic to you. Before I finish, an important reality check. I, in no way, wanted to feel that you should follow everything that I talked about today. This is knowledge that arms you, and it's for you to decide what you use and what you leave. The thing that almost always backfires is perfectionism. Embrace your imperfections and your everlasting journey of growing and gathering experiences. That being said, I'd love to hear what hacks you are already practicing and whether there was something that surprised you, maybe.